In this video, we're computing the moment of inertia of a solid sphere of mass m and radius r by using nested spherical shells. Now, I've posted previous videos where we've used disks and we've used cylindrical shells to do this same calculation, and I'll post links to those derivations at the top. And what happens when you use disks or cylindrical shells for this calculation is that you end up having to grind through some pretty treacherous integrals because the symmetry of the mass increment, whether it's a disk or a cylinder, doesn't match the symmetry of a sphere very well. So this time we're going to use the perfect tool for deriving the moment of inertia of a solid ball. And that's the thin spherical shell, which shares the spherical symmetry of the ball and produces a very simple integral as a result. So in the instructions, we're given the moment of inertia of a thin spherical shell, and that's 2/3 mr squared. And I actually just published that video a week ago, so I'll put a link to that at the top as well. Okay, so we're going to call the radius of our shell little r, and as little r goes from 0 to big R, we build the entire sphere out of nested shells. Note that our shell wall has an infinitesimal thickness that we call dr, and the shell contains an infinitesimal amount of mass, so we call that dm. Our first goal here is to express dm in terms of the geometry of the shell. Ultimately, we want everything expressed in terms of r, which is going to be our integration variable. And we have to start by using the density of the material, and we use the Greek letter rho for that. So we write dm equals rho dv, because density multiplied by volume gives us mass. And we note that there's an incremental volume contained in that shell wall called dv because it's infinitesimal. So how do we find the volume dv contained in a thin spherical shell? Well, since I'm wearing my physics hat at the moment, I'm just going to wave my hands around a little and say the volume in the shell is given by the surface area multiplied by the thickness. And since the surface area of a sphere is 4 pi r squared, we get 4 pi r squared times dr. To some students, this approach seems obvious, but we can justify it at a deeper level. So if I dust off my math hat and spend a moment just being rigorous, we can write down the volume of this shell precisely. By taking the difference in volume between a sphere with radius r plus dr, that's the outer wall of the shell, and a sphere with radius r, so we're just deleting the interior of a solid sphere to get the volume of the shell. So this gives us 4/3 pi times the quantity r plus dr cubed, that's the volume of the outer sphere, minus 4/3 pi times little r cubed, that's the volume of the inner sphere, and it leaves us just with the volume of a spherical shell with a thickness of dr. Next, we cube that binomial r plus dr. So there's the piece that results from cubing the actual binomial. Now I notice that the r cubed terms are going to cancel out. And so we're left with 4/3 pi times the quantity 3r squared dr plus 3r times dr squared plus dr cubed. And now we kind of have to think like a physicist again, and I mean we're going to prioritize the art of approximation. Dr is an infinitesimal quantity. Think of it like 1/1,000,000,000th of a meter, except even smaller than that. Well, if you square a really small number like this, you get an even smaller number, like 1/1,000,000,000th of a meter, except even smaller than that. So what I'm saying is that the terms containing higher powers of dr are negligible as dr approaches zero. So the terms with higher powers of dr are going to cancel out of this expression. And now when we look at the leftover pieces, we see we can cancel a factor of 3 out of that. And we arrive at the expression 4 pi r squared dr for the volume in the shell. So this seemed like a good idea at first, and now we know it's a good idea. Surface area times thickness gives you the volume in a shell. So our setup is really coming together now that we know how to write down dm. We're going to say our moment of inertia contribution for this spherical shell is 2/3 times the mass times the radius squared. Again, that's just using the previously derived formula for the moment of inertia of a thin shell. Now we can replace dm with density times volume, just multiplying our result for dv by a factor of rho. And we can clean things up a little, combining the constants out in front and combining all four factors of little r in this expression. And we obtain 8/3 rho pi r to the fourth dr for the moment of inertia contribution of a single thin spherical shell. So now that we've expressed our moment of inertia contribution entirely in terms of little r, we're ready to add up all the contributions using a physical integral. So we write that the total moment of inertia is the sum of all the di's, and that's what an integral does, summing up all the differential contributions. And then we just replace di with our expression in terms of r. And so we're left with the integral of 8/3 rho pi r to the fourth dr. And again, the limits of integration go from 0 to big R as we build up this solid sphere from nested shells. So now it's just a matter of computing this integral, and we're going to find out that this one is refreshingly simple. So in this integral, little r is the integration variable and everything else is constants. So we can highlight that fact by writing the constants out in front. So this leaves us with an integral from 0 to big R of r to the fourth dr. Well, that's just a basic power rule integral. That's going to integrate to 1/5 r to the fifth. While I'm writing down this step, I'm going to combine the 1/5 with the 8/3 that's out in front. So we end up with 8 over 15. And there's our little r to the fifth evaluated from 0 to big R. Note that when we plug in the lower limit of this, we just get a 0. So that's gone. All we have to do is sub in big R for little r. And this leaves us with 8/15 rho pi big R to the fifth. So that's one way of writing down the final answer for the moment of inertia of this ball. But to get the formula that we're familiar with, we have to sub out that density term, rho, and write that in terms of the geometry of the sphere. So recall that rho is mass divided by volume. So we can write down the density of this sphere as the total mass divided by 4/3 pi big R cubed. Just to keep things simpler, I'm going to write this as a single fraction. And that's 3m over 4 pi r cubed. Now we just replace the rho in our expression for the moment of inertia, and we start to clean things up. So first I notice that some of the constants are going to cancel. I can cancel a factor of 4. That leaves me with a 2 in the numerator. I can cancel a factor of 3, leaving me with a 5 in the denominator. So our constants clean up to 2/5. Then we can cancel a factor of pi, and we can cancel 3 factors of big R. So that leaves me with an R squared in the numerator. Bringing down this leftover factor of M, we have 2/5 times M R squared. And we recognize the standard formula for the moment of inertia of a solid sphere, so we're done. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.